kidney disease, diabetes, cerebral palsy, genetic disorders. These are a few of the many afflictions that my next guest and his team at the University of Rochester Medical Center are most interested in navigating. But the navigation is just one part of the equation. Another is making discoveries that could possibly alter the treatment of health conditions with no sufficient therapies. His work spans everything from stem cell biology and medicine to research on drug repurposing. And he says it's all in an effort to make the world a better place. Joining me now to share more about his research, work, and the future of stem cell medicine is Mark Noble, professor of genetics and neurobiology and anatomy at the University of Rochester Medical Center and director of the UR Stem Cell and Regenerative Medicine Institute. Welcome to the show. I should say welcome back. It's been a few years. So welcome back.
Thank you so much.
So Mark, you are the epitome of a person that's difficult to keep up with because you wear many different hats and do a number of different things in this field. And I've read that you've spent the core of your career in science focused on examining and understanding the unique properties of special cells. So to give viewers a better understanding of what you do, what are you looking for as a biomedical scientist?
Well, what I'm personally looking for is treatments for these horrible afflictions for which we have no therapies at the moment. And in particular, what we're looking for is general principles that allow us to potentially treat multiple diseases. So you can approach this by working very hard on a particular disease, and that's what a lot of laboratories do, and it's a great way to do it. But if you can find the general principle, then you may have the opportunity to actually help a lot of people, as well as decreasing the cost of therapeutic development, because now you have a therapy that can be used over and over again.
Can you give an example so viewers understand of when you've discovered something and you struck gold, so to speak?
Well, it's a good time right now. So one of the areas of research that we've recently published on is our work on a problem in disease which involves a part of the cell called a lysosome. So a lysosome is the stomach of the cell, and it really works like a stomach. It digests lipids and proteins, provides them as nutrients for the cell. And when it doesn't work properly, you have very serious problems. And what's become clear is that lysosome dysfunction is important in Parkinson's and Alzheimer's and diabetes, but there's 40 to 50 diseases that are caused by mutations in proteins that need to function in the lysosome. And a lot of these diseases are just devastating. They kill kids within 2 or 3 years, and we have no treatments. So we decided to go after the worst of these diseases. And with a couple of absolutely spectacular students, Chris Fultz and Nicole Scott Hewitt, we were able to make some actually quite revolutionary discoveries of how to intervene in these diseases in a way that gives us access to multiple diseases. Mm-hmm. And we were able to do this by discovering new properties of existing drugs. So we shortened the road to exploring this clinically. And in collaborations with my colleague Chris Preschel, our hope that by working on the worst of these diseases, we would get insights relevant to other diseases. It looks like what we're working on may be very relevant to Parkinson's disease.
Interesting. So this ties in with the drug repurposing. Mm-hmm. And talk a little bit about what types of therapeutic benefits, I want to make sure we kind of drill down into this to get a better understanding, have you found with what you've described?
So when we look at animal models for these diseases, there is one animal model that we particularly like to study because in it the mice are born normal, they get sick at day 20, they're dead at day 40. So you have a very nice timing in which to look at interventions. And we are able to decrease, even prevent a lot of the damage in the central nervous system that occurs in this disease. We're able to improve what you'd call quality of life for these mice, improve their motor behavior, we extend their lifespan. And we do all of this without fancy techniques of gene therapy or cell transplantation. Now we're in a position to explore how these drugs might be combined with other drugs in ways that maybe we hope could help some of these kids.
And in addition to the health benefits, are there financial benefits associated with something like that in terms of cost?
Well, the pharmaceutical industry will tell you that it costs $1 billion or more to develop a drug. And I believe, and others believe, that that can be greatly decreased. And that's one of the reasons why we take existing drugs and discover new properties of them. Because then we know the toxicology, we know the dosage, we don't have to do that stuff. We can focus on how we would use them for treating a disease for which they've never been used before. That decreases costs on one end. Because many of the drugs that we've discovered new uses of are actually generics, we can now explore how to bring them to the clinic at a decreased cost. And we have to decrease the cost of medical care. There was a very interesting editorial by one of the senior deans of oncology for the United Kingdom after one of the recent big cancer meetings. The big buzz these days in cancer research is getting the body's immune system to attack cancer cells. For a small fraction of people, this is curative. For a somewhat larger group of people, it can extend lifespan. But what Dr. Sakura said was that with the projected cost of these treatments, there's not enough money in the entire budget for the entire National Health Service of the entire United Kingdom just to treat the cancer patients. So we've got to do better than that. And that's one of the great advantages of this approach that I and many of my colleagues are taking.
And I want to ask you, Mark, with drug repurposing and the right. approach that you're describing, is there a connection at all, you can school me on this, yeah. when it comes to stem cell research, stem cell biology, medicine?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. Everything we do is based on stem cells. So we use stem cells as a discovery tool. And when we're trying to find a new approach to a disease, we'll choose an appropriate stem cell or other type of cell that can make cells of the body and use it as our target. Now, sometimes we're trying to improve its function, but in cancer, you have the stem cells, fundamentally the stem cells' evil twin. So just like in the normal body, you may have a small population of stem cells that replenish the tissue. In cancers, many cancers have a small population of cancer stem cells that replenish the tumor, and they're very resistant to therapy. So our goal there has been to discover pathways that distinguish the cancer stem cell from normal stem cells, to target those pathways, and to go in and use that as a means of therapeutic development. And that's been extraordinarily successful.
I'm going to pull back just a little bit and touch upon something that you were joking when you said this, and I saw a TEDx talk with you, and you mm-hmm. said, hey, I have to keep it real. Stem cells are incredibly boring. And I know that that was a right. joke that you were making. But for those who are watching right now and they're saying, I don't understand how this connects to me. Cancer hasn't touched my family. Some of these things that they've mentioned may not have touched my family. Why is it important to understand how stem cells work and what's happening right now with this research?
So when you look at many of the diseases for which we have no therapies, cancer cells, for example, now that we understand about cancer stem cells, we have a therapeutic target that we can aim at. Moreover, what my team and I discovered about a decade ago was that many of the standard cancer therapies are more toxic for the normal precursor cells, stem cells, and more restricted cells of the brain than they are toxic for cancer cells. So by going after ways of selectively targeting the cancer stem cells, we also are looking to develop therapies that are safer. So that's just cancer. But let's look if we look at lysosomal storage disorders, a disease group we're very interested in, the effect 1 in 80 to 1 in 100,000 children. That's not a large number of people, but it's a well-deserving population of people. Parkinson's disease afflicts 1.6% of the population. Alzheimer's even more than that. These are also diseases in which the lysosome, this organ of the cell, becomes dysfunctional and contributes to the disease process. Now that begins to affect a lot of people. And it's very hard to find a family in which these diseases of aging are not problematic. And I should say that a lot of the general principles that we study apply to aging in general, it appears. So that also makes it relevant. We're all touched by these. in one way or another.
For those watching, Mark, and they might be thinking, isn't there an ethical debate wrapped up with the stem cell movement? How prevalent is that today? That debate that we heard so much about when news right. really broke about stem cells?
Right. The wonderful thing about science is that we're always moving forward. This is what I know it's very confusing for people when scientists disagree with each other, but this is part of what we do, because every day we're going in to try and find out how we were wrong about what we believed yesterday. So fields are always moving forward. And one of the spectacular advances in stem cell biology, and this is just so fantastic. I can take cells from your skin, and I can put them through a sequence of steps in a tissue culture dish, and I can turn them into nerve cells. I can turn them into muscle cells. I can turn them into heart cells. I can turn them into the cells that produce insulin in the pancreas. And those cells all come from you. So the hope is that by using that kind of methodology, we can make cells where you don't even have to do immune suppression.
Got it. So in that case, then, you don't have to deal with the embryonic stem cells, correct?
The field has, I'm not going to say it's moved beyond that, mm-hmm. because discovery is a continuum. And the principles that we learn from studying embryonic stem cells provide the principles for doing this work on what we call them induced pluripotent stem cells. So science always spans this complete continuum, but more and more the ability to derive important cell types from cells of someone's own body is becoming central to the research effort.
I know I'm jumping around a bit, but I'm going to go to something. Recently, you and fellow researchers at the University of Rochester Medical Center, you published a study in which you announced you may have identified a new way to help the body repair its own cells. We kind of touched upon this, which could lead to improved diagnosis and treatment of traumatic nerve injuries. So I want to talk about this. This was in November when this came out,
That's
this study.
Right.
I'm jumping around, but with drug repurposing and what you're doing and finding, is this relatively rare, or is this something that's more common now?
It's becoming very common. That initially, people who were doing this were concerned that, in the end, we only have a small number of approved drugs we can work with, right? So, and we have all these problems we're trying to solve. But what's become very clear? We've known for a long time that drugs are dirty. They have what are called side effects. Well, sometimes those side effects may be main effects for purposes of another disease, and we can discover aspects of these drugs that nobody ever knew before. And that enables us to use them in new ways. So I think that the ability of a drug to get through all the tests that make it into a medicine is based in some respect on properties that we don't yet understand. And those properties can be, it appears, exploited for other purposes. Those of us who are doing this now are finding a lot of successes.
So what is it for you that makes the work you do on a daily basis so exciting? What is, because I know you said, I mean, when I spoke with you in advance of our conversation, and I could tell that this is something that it's challenging but also exciting at the exact same time. I mean, is there something that you hope that you would say in the next 5 to 10 years, I hope that we can, my lab, that we can achieve this or find this or discover this?
Oh, there's a lot. A lot of this work is heading towards clinical trials. And the opportunity to impact on someone else's life. Wow, what's better than that?
Yeah.
That is, it's not the only reason to go into science, that you study science to make the universe a more beautiful place, by understanding these incredible questions of how we go from a single cell to a you, right? What a wonderful problem to study.
Well, I appreciate your time. We have to close for now, but we'll look forward to having you back on the show in the near future. There's much to discover with you and your work and in your research. A special thank you to Mark Noble for your time. I appreciate it. You can learn more about the work of Mark Noble and his team at the University of Rochester Medical Center. Just go to urmc.rochester.edu and search for Noble Labs in the search engine.